Jesus Christ is the inspirer of the book of Revelation. It's the revelation of Jesus that God gave to him and that he gave to John through the angels. And Jesus also has some words for us in Mark chapter 7, verses 7 and 9. These words, I think, are very much applicable to the issue that we're dealing with here. Jesus was talking to the Pharisees and the religious leaders of his time because most of the time in history, the religious leaders have been on the wrong side. And we find this taking place at the end of time, too. And in Mark chapter 7, verse 7, Jesus says, "Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." And in verse 9, he says, "Full well you reject the commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition." So to follow man, to receive the mark of the beast, to receive the number of the beast, is to follow man's teachings, man's doctrines, man's authority, is to worship God according to man's laws and man's commandments and reject the commandment of God. And that is the issue that is brought to view there.
There's another parallel passage, friends, in the book of Daniel. We've looked at Revelation chapters 13 and 14, which warns of the beast power receiving the worship that is only due to God. We've looked at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, where again we're told that the Antichrist will exalt itself above God and will be a power that is lawless, that promotes lawlessness. And now another parallel passage in Daniel chapter 7, we have the little horn power, which is equivalent to the beast power and the Antichrist. And it says in verse 25 of Daniel 7 that this power, this Antichrist, the beast, will seek to change the times and laws of the Most High, of God Almighty Himself. And so we're very, very clear here in the Scriptures as to the activity of the Antichrist, the movements of the beast power, exactly what that power is up to in the course that it's pursuing. It is attacking the law of God. And as in our previous study, we've seen that the seal of God is vitally connected with His law in the Sabbath commandment. We're seeing now that the mark of the beast is a direct attack on the law of God. And when we come back in just a moment, friends, we're going to clearly see just what aspect of the law of God has been attacked through the mark of the beast. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
It was over 12 years ago, I was traveling the countryside of Norway when I was given tapes of Thai preaching. Well, they proved to be such a blessing. And I'm so glad that you can have the blessing right in your own home. Lift Him Up is an ongoing television series designed to make God's Word clear and exalt Christ as the central theme of the Bible. James and Ty are eager to share with you as much as possible. That is why they prepared a series of study guides just for you. They want you to have these study guides absolutely free. All you have to do is call 1-877-585-1111 or write to Light Bearers Ministry, Malo, Washington, 99150. Or email your request to lbm@televar.com. Ask for the Revelation 14 study guides.
Welcome back, friends, to our continuing study on the mark of the beast and the seal of God. We have clearly seen that the issue of Revelation 13 is worship. And since the issue of worship of the first two beasts in Revelation 13, or worship of God, we must come to the conclusion that there is a difference between the two. It is important to note today that every Christian denomination worships God on one of two days, either Saturday or Sunday. A small remnant of Christians worship God on Saturday, the seventh day of the week. They do this in accordance with the Word of God and the commandments of God, Exodus chapter 20, Genesis chapter 2, believing that the Sabbath commandment was given not just to the Jews, but to mankind at the creation of this earth. But there are a majority body of Christians who worship God on Sunday, the first day of the week. Now, many reasons can be stated for this. It's the day that Jesus rose from the grave. It is the day that my fathers have kept, and it's traditional with us as a family. It was the day that the disciples broke bread together. But since none of these reasons are based on a direct command from the Word of God, even though Sunday is the Sabbath for many Christians, it is not the Bible Sabbath. However, there is a large group of Christians, 850 million plus Christians, who can give another reason for their worship of God on Sunday. Not necessarily because it's traditional with the fathers or traditional with the disciples, but rather because it is a teaching of their church, the Catholic Church. It says in the Catholic Catechism, question, have you any other way of proving that the Church, the Roman Catholic Church, has power to institute festivals of precept? Answer, had she not such power, she could not have done that in which all modern religionists agree with her. She could not have substituted the observance of Sunday, the first day of the week, for the observance of Saturday, the seventh day, a change for which there is not scriptural authority. Question, which is the seventh Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church in the Council of Laodicea 364 transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. So the papacy has changed the day that we worship God from Saturday to Sunday, and this is in accordance with the prophecies we've been reading in the Bible.
We've noticed, James, three parallel passages. We've looked at Revelation 13 and 14, which calls our attention to the issue of worship in connection with the law, the commandments of God. We've looked at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, where this power, the Antichrist, exalts itself above God and receives the worship of God. And Paul says this is the mystery of iniquity in verse 7, the mystery of lawlessness, as the Greek reads. And then we noticed in Daniel chapter 7, verse 25, that the Antichrist attempts to change God's law. So clearly here, we're dealing with an issue that centers in the law of God. Not only does the papacy claim that they did in fact change the Sabbath from the seventh day, Saturday, to Sunday, the first day, but also it's very interesting to note that in papal literature and literature from Catholic authors, we find that the change is acknowledged to be or claimed to be a mark of the authority of the papacy in religious matters. For example, in The Faith of Our Fathers by Cardinal Gibbon on page 14, we read, of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change was her act, that is, the change from Saturday to Sunday. And the act is the mark, notice friends, the mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. So here we have a professed Christian system exalting itself above God in that it changes the law of God or attempts to do so and calls upon the world, the Christian world in particular, to yield allegiance to this power rather than yielding allegiance to God and worshiping Him according to His clear biblical commandment to worship on the seventh day as a commemorative worship of Him as Creator and Redeemer.
So as a beast in prophecy represents an earthly kingdom or a power, the mark of the beast would represent the distinguishing feature of that power. Mm-hmm. And what we're reading in these statements that Rome is saying is that the change of worship from the seventh day Sabbath to Sunday is the mark of our authority to overrule God's law. What we find here, friends, is not just an understanding that the Antichrist is against Christ, but the word anti in the Greek actually means and is used in the New Testament as in the place of, in the place of. As we look at these prophecies, we recognize that the papal power has put its law and its authority in the place of God's law and in the place of God's authority, as it says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, seeking the world to worship it in the place of worshiping God.
Let's make this absolutely clear, friends, that we're not dealing here, God is not dealing here with individual people. As a matter of fact, when we read the prophecies of Revelation, we notice that when the call is given to come out of Babylon in chapter 14, verse 8 of Revelation, and chapter 18, verses 1 through 4, that God specifically says, come out of her, out of this false